Hello friends, my name is Mohsin Mulla and I welcome you to this video lecture on Unit 2 Industrial Instrumentation of Industrial Automation and Control. In this video lecture, we are going to see displacement and speed measurement. Displacement and speed are two important parameters whose measurements are important in many position and speed control schemes. Error-free measurements of these two parameters are necessary in order to achieve good control performance. Displacement measurement can be of different types. The displacement may be in the range of few micrometer to few centimeters. Moreover, the measurement may be of contact type or non-contact type. Again, displacement to be measured can be linear or angular. Similar is the case for speed measurement. So speed can also be measured with the help of a contact type of meters or non-contact type of meters, and it can also be measured in a linear way or in the angular way or rotary way. Displacement measurement. Broadly speaking, displacement measurement can be of two types, contact and non-contact types. Besides, the measurement principles can be classified into two categories: electrical sensing and optical sensing. In electrical sensing, passive electrical sensors are used. Variation of either inductance or capacitance with displacement is measured. On the other hand, the optical method mainly works on the principle of intensity of variation of light with distance. Next is the potentiometer. Potentiometers are simplest type of displacement sensors. They are contact sensors. They can be used for linear as well as angular displacement measurement, which is shown in the next slide. Now they are the resistive type of transducers, and the output voltage is proportional to the displacement and is given by E naught equal to XI divided by XT into E, where XI is the input displacement, XT is the total displacement, and E is the supply voltage. So as you can see in this picture over here, in figure A, it is the linear type of displacement measurement method, wherein XI is the input displacement and XT is the total displacement, or you can say the range of displacement that can be measured. Now, depending upon the input displacement, XI value, output voltage E naught is going to change, and E naught is directly measure of the displacement. If say the position of that XI is at this particular level here, so in that case the E naught value is zero. It means that there is no displacement, and when this XI value increases, it moves on the resistance will increase. So as the resistance will increase, at the same time there will be increase in the output voltage E naught. So at this particular position, the output voltage E naught is larger than the whatever output voltage it had obtained in the previous case. So likewise, this XI can increase from this position up to the maximum resistance position, and when it reaches to that maximum position, so it will be giving us the maximum displacement that the meter can measure. In the same way, rotary displacement can be measured with the help of a rotary type of measuring instrument here, potentiometer itself, but it measures angular displacement. So here the first position of, again, the output voltage E naught is measured depending upon the input displacement XI. Here the input displacement XI is not linear, but it is angular, which is theta I. So therefore, when the angular displacement starts increasing from this zero position, the displacement, angular displacement will increase. And as theta I increases, correspondingly there will be increase in the E naught value. Therefore, directly the angular displacement can be measured with the help of this rotary type of potentiometer. Okay, so the major problem with the potentiometers is the contact problem resulting out of wear and tear between the moving and the fixed parts. As a result, though simple, application of potentiometers is limited. Next is linear variable differential transformer or LVDT. So here basically this is a contactless type of meter. So LVDT works on the principle of variation of mutual inductance. It is one of the most popular types of displacement sensors. It has good linearity over a wide range of displacement. Moreover, the mass of the moving body is small and the moving body does not make any contact with the static part, thus minimizing the functional resistance. Commercial LVDTs are available with full-scale displacement range of 0.25 mm to 25 mm. So the LVDT type of measuring instrument can measure the displacement ranging from 0.25 in either direction to 25 mm. So plus or minus means here with respect to a central position, either it can measure on the positive side, so that is plus value, or it can measure on the other side, which is a negative value. So the plus and minus essentially indicate the direction of the displacement. Due to the low inertia of the core, the LVDT has a good dynamic characteristics and can be used for time varying displacement measurement range. So here is the constructional details of the LVDT type of displacement measuring instruments. So here essentially there is a primary coil and there is a secondary coil. So here the primary coil will be energized. So this part and this part are the primary coils, whereas this part and this part on the either side are the secondary coils. Now the primary coil will be energized with the reference voltage value, and this secondary coils are measuring the induced EMF in when the ferromagnetic core is moved in the direction here. So now depending upon the placement of this ferromagnetic core, the value induced in this in this part is V2 and in this part is V1. So if the position of ferromagnetic core is central and there is no displacement, in that case V1 and V2 are equal, and hence the value of the displacement measured is the difference of the V1 and V2. Therefore V1 minus V2 will be equal to 0, so there is no displacement. And when there is a displacement, in that case, if the ferromagnetic core moves in this direction, in that case this V2 value will be larger than the V1 value. Hence the difference V1 minus V2 will be essentially a negative value, which indicates the direction is right hand side. Similarly, when the ferromagnetic core moves in the other direction, that is on the left hand side, in that case V1 value will be larger than the V2 value, and therefore this difference V1 minus V2 will be plus when the direction is from left to right. So likewise the displacement is measured with the help of that, and the magnitude of the difference will give us the total displacement, and signs will give us the direction of the displacement. Okay, so here the same thing is explained in clear way. So the two secondary coils are connected in series but in the opposing manner. Therefore the total voltage induced in the secondary coil is the difference of the two individual coils here. So that is the same theoretical explanation here. So the primary winding is excited by 1 to 10 volt RMS AC voltage source. The output voltage is 0 when the core is at the central position, but the increasing as the core moves away from the central position in either direction. So here basically to measure the final displacement, the direct magnitude is not directly used to measure the displacement, but rather a phase sensitive detector is used in order to determine the direction of the displacement. Hence a phase sensitive detector, what it will do is it will take the signal and it will convert it into a DC value. So the DC value will be either positive value or it will be either negative value depending upon the direction, and that steady value when the displacement is fixed from one particular point to the next point, in that case this DC value will reach to a particular position and it will remain there. Okay, so as it will move near to the original position, the DC value will be zero, and as it moves further, so the displacement is farther from the original position, so the DC value will be higher, and when there is no moment, again the value of that voltage will be zero. So this essentially indicates the displacement. Okay, so here is the characteristics of the PSD versus the displacement, okay, which clearly indicates the voltage level of DC value, and this is the linear range. Okay, so this linear range means that is the range of the meter which can measure the displacement. So beyond that, it will remain constant. So even if there is a movement, it is not going to detect any displacement, as it will reach to its steady value at this particular point. And later on, even if there is movement, so it is beyond the you can say detection range of the meter, so it is not going to detect any induced EMF, so that time the voltage will become zero. So essentially we can have different range meters depending upon the requirement of the measurement. Next is inductive type sensors. LVDT works on the principle of variation of mutual inductance. Okay, there are inductive sensors, measurement of displacement, those are based on the principle variation of self-inductance. These sensors can be used for proximity detection also. Such a typical scheme is shown in the figure 3. In the case of inductance, inductance of a coil changes as ferromagnetic object moves close to the magnetic former, thus change in the reluctance of the magnetic path. So here it can be the same principle can be used for the metal detection or any object detection. So there will be a object, so that is a essentially metallic part or ferromagnetic object. So now there is a system which will have a coil wound on the core, so whose magnetic flux is fixed when there is a fixed supply to that, but as soon as there is a metal contact or there is a displacement of the you can say that target object, so then there will be change in the reluctance of the this path between the core and the ferromagnetic material. Because of that, the flux will change. Okay, so therefore it will directly detect the displacement. If the flux decreases, so that is the indication that the displacement is higher, and if the flux is constant, there is no displacement, and if the flux is higher, in that case the displacement is towards the core. Okay, so like that it can be used, and same can be used for the metal detection also. Next is rotary variable differential transformer, which is also called as RVDT. So here basically the core is moved in the angular manner. It is not moved in the linear fashion, but it is moved in the angular fashion. So the same thing again, when it is not moving and it is at the central position, in that case this coil and this coil have the induced voltage V1 and V2, which are equal to each other. So because of that, as they are in opposition connection, so V1 minus V2 will be essentially zero when there is no movement. And when there is a movement, suppose the ferromagnetic core has moved on this side, so V1 will be larger, so V1 minus V2 will be at that time a positive value, okay, indicating the direction. And similarly, when the coil moves on the other side, at that time V1 minus V2 will essentially be a negative value, indicating the coil has been moved in the other direction. So this plus will indicate this direction and minus will indicate the this direction, or you can say this is the anti-clockwise direction and this is the clockwise direction of the movement. So in this way also the displacement, angular displacement of the target object can be measured. So next is resolvers. Resolvers also work on the principle of mutual inductance variation and are widely used for measurement of rotary motion. The basic construction is as shown in the figure. Next, resolver consists of a rotor containing primary coil and two stator windings with equal number of turns placed perpendicular to each other. The rotor is directly attached to the object whose rotation is being measured. If AC excitation of RMS voltage VR is applied, then the induced voltages at two stator coils are given by, so for x-axis position of the stator, it is given as KVR cos theta, and for the y-axis position of the stator, it is given by KVR into sin theta, where K is a constant. By measuring these two voltages, the angular position can be uniquely determined. So here is the whatever resolver explanation is there. So it is the construction of a resolver. So there is a stator core in the horizontal position whose induced voltage is given by this expression here, and there is second stator which is positioned in the vertical manner and whose induced voltage is given by this expression here. Now the rotor, so which will be usually revolving. So now when the rotor is revolving, when it moves near to the this side, so in that case the V2 value have induced value higher than the V0 one. Again, it is, you can say, the difference of the two voltages V1, V0 one and V0 2. So when the rotor is in the central position of the two stators, in that case, so both the voltages are same, but as soon as the rotor is slightly displaced from its position, in that case we can measure the positive value of the displacement, okay, because it is V0 1 minus V0 2, so V0 1 will be larger and V0 2 will be smaller. V0 2 will be larger and V0 1 will be smaller. So because of that, we'll get the negative value of the magnitude. Similarly, when it is moving in the other direction, that is clockwise direction, in that case we are going to get V0 1 as larger value and V0 2 as smaller value. So in that case it will be, so for anti-clockwise it will be negative and for clockwise direction it will be positive. So this will give us the displacement of the rotor from its central position. So this is, you can say, one of the application can be used for placing the rotor inside a stator, because it needs to be placed exactly at the center. So if there is any induced EMF on the either side of the any difference in the induced EMF on either side of the stator core, so in that case, so we can adjust the position of the rotor so that the difference is equal to zero. That will give us the central position of the stator core. Okay, so next is the capacitance sensors. So apart from the induced EMF, so we can also use the capacitance type of sensors, as it is a versatile one. It is available in the different sizes and shapes. It can also measure very small displacement in micrometer range. Often the whole sensor is fabricated in a silicon base and is integrated with the processing circuit to form a small chip. The basic principle of a capacitance sensor is well known, but to understand the various modes of operation, consider the capacitance formed by two parallel plates separated by a dielectric. The capacitance between the plates is given by this expression here, C equal to epsilon R epsilon naught A divided by D, where epsilon naught is the absolute permittivity of the medium, air, and epsilon R is the relative permittivity of the medium, and A is the cross-sectional area of the plate, and D is the distance between the, or the displacement between the two plates. Okay, so as we know that the capacitance will increase as area will increase, so C is directly proportional to A and C is inversely proportional to the difference between the two plates, and you can just imagine the two plates like this. So here it will be the cross-sectional area and this is the difference between the two plates, okay, that is distance between the two plates D. Okay, so now the capacitance, so if one of the two plates are energized and other plates, a plate acts as the target, which will be say at the ground potential, then the capacitance will change as the plate will change its position. So if this is energized and this is say ground connected, when this is moving away, in that case, so the D is going to increase, so that increase in D will give rise to increase in the capacitance, so that will be the direct indication of displacement of the target object. Similarly, if it moves towards the plate, in that case D is going to reduce, in that case the capacitance is going to reduce, so that is again going to give the displacement in the other direction. So likewise, the area can also be used in the overlap type of you can say arrangement, so which can be shown with the help of these figures here. So this is the fixed type of displacement measurement, so where you can say the distance is the variable used to measure the capacitance and the you can say to measure the displacement. Okay, so which is called as variable separation type of meter. Then there is a variable area, so in which the displacement is nothing but the overlap area. Variable is the area, so here this is the displacement, or you can say overlapping, so that overlapping will give us the area which is acting as the two parallel plates. So only this much area of the plates is now acting as the two parallel plates. So if the original position of this is like this, so the two plates are exactly overlapping with each other, so then there is total overlapping. In that case, as C is directly proportional to A, so the total area of overlapping is highest here, so therefore the capacitance will be highest in this case. But as the second plate is moving towards other side, so in that case, so it can move in this side or in this side. So now let us say if it is moving in this side, then there is reduction in the overlapping by this much area. So if the second area is say A1, so this area is overlapping area is less than the earlier area A, therefore this capacitance C1 will smaller than the earlier capacitance C. So this will indicate the displacement in one particular direction. So similarly, the direction can be on the other side, and the same can be obtained. So in that case, it might be with the say the direction of the electric field intensity will be in the opposite direction, so that can also be, you can say, exploited to determine the direction of the displacement also. So this is the basic principle of capacitive type of sensors used for the measurement of displacement. Now here is one arrangement shown. So basically here one plate is used, okay, so which is having two circular surfaces. One is head A and another one is the head B. So now there is a fixed capacitance between the two plates A and B, but when the target is approaching towards the plate, at that time the head A and this target will interact with each other. Because of that, the reduction, there will be difference in the capacitance experienced by A and B. So that will be the direct indication of the displacement of the target object. So when the target is not moving, or it is at a particular reference position, so this is the reference position, at that time there will be a known capacitance between A and B. Okay, so say that capacitance is CAB. Okay, so that capacitance will be known. But as soon as the target is moving towards the object, in that case there will be change in the capacitance A and B, as A is directly experiencing the second target plate also, as it is at the elevated position from the plate B. So the plate B at the lower position and this is at the elevated position. So because of that, there is a difference between A and B, because this capacitance is between this and this, and there is another capacitance between this and this. So when this moves, there will be change in this capacitance also. Okay, so that will be the indication of the displacement, and this type of meter can be used for the measurement of displacement up to 5 centimeters. Okay, so also this type of meter can be used in the proximity type of sensors. Now, optical sensors. So here Basically, light is used as the way of measuring the displacement. So the optical displacement sensors work on the basic principle that the intensity of light decreases with distance. So if the source and detector are fixed, the amount of light reflected from a moving surface will depend on the distance of the moving surface from the fixed ones. Optical fibers are often used to transmit light to and from the measuring zone. Such a scheme with bundle of fibers is shown in next slide. It uses two bundle of fibers, one for transmitting of light from the source and the other one is for the reflecting the light from the detector. And the light source used can be here the laser light or LED, and the detector can be used as the photodiodes and photo transistors, which will detect the incoming light. Okay, so here is the arrangement for that photo sensor or optic sensor. So here these are the fixed position of the sensors. That is, the one is light source, okay, and there is another one, the photo detector. So one emits the light and another one receives the light here. Okay, so now to emit the light here, it optical fibers, bundle of optical fibers is used. Okay, so and again for receiving the light, emitted light, bundle of fibers is used. Now there is a power source used for producing the light here or emitting the light. If it is a laser or LED, it requires a power, so that will be supplied from this power source here. Okay, and similarly there is a signal processing unit. So whatever light is emitted, it might be in the low in intensity. So to understand the variation in the intensity or to observe the change in the intensity, a signal processor is used, which will directly convert the change in the intensity into a required parameter, which will directly determine the position or the displacement of the object here. So now when the object is placed in this particular fixed position, in that case the sent light will be reflected with the known intensity. So there is no change in the position. So reference intensity will be measured and it will detect there is no change in the displacement. But as soon as the object moves in the opposite direction or away from the these two detectors here, these two fixed detectors here, in that case the intensity of the light goes on reducing as this distance is goes on increasing. Okay, so that reduction in the intensity is directly resulted in the reduction in the photo detector or photo emitters. Photo diodes will emit the light, so photo emitters and also the photo transistor will detect that change in reduction in the intensity. Okay, so therefore this signal processor will process that reduction in the intensity of the light, which will directly give us the measurement that the object is moving farther from the target here. Okay, so now this type of principle is usually used to measure the you can say movement of the vehicles. Okay, so here usually the policeman will hold a speedometer, or you can say speed detecting meter. Okay, so that will emit a laser light on the vehicle, back of the vehicle, so which will emit back, and depending upon the way it is moving away, the speed of the vehicle is measured here. So in that way also the displacement can be measured depending upon the required application. For different distances it can be designed for various applications. Then speed measurement. The simplest way for speed measurement is of course direct contact type, okay, which is called as a TACO generator. So as we engage the TACO generator with the shaft of the rotating motor, so in that case that generator will produce the you can say proportional quantity of the voltage, which will directly give us the indication of the speed of the motor or rotating shaft. But this is not the you can say most efficient way of measuring it, as we need to engage in the rotating rotor. So instead of that we can use, there is non-contact type of meters also available which can be used for the measurement of the speed. Okay, so the first optical method is an First method is an optical method, so where an opaque disc with perforations or transparent windows at regular interval is mounted on the rotating shaft whose speed is to be measured. Then LED source is aligned on one side of the disc in such a way that its light can pass through the transparent window of the disc. As the disc rotates, the light will alternately pass through the transparent windows and blocked by the opaque sections. Therefore, we are going to get pulses like this whenever there is open window section comes. At that time, one signal will be generated. So depending upon the number of pulses, means in a circular disc, we will be having a known number of pulses. So we'll measure that the how much time it will take to get all the pulses here. So depending upon that time to get all the pulses, we'll come to know whether the speed is low, or say in one second, say there are 10 windows available, then we should get 10 pulses in 1 second. And suppose if it is taking, then at that time we can determine the speed for that particular. So we have the, we can say, direct relationship between the time and the speed, so that can be directly measured. Okay, so as we know the area of the disc, therefore, so this can be used to measure the speed of the rotor. So here it is indicated. So usually there will be a rotating motor on which there will be a disc placed. Okay, and this disc will be fixed with the so there will be a LED source available on this side, and there is a on one side there is a LED source is placed, and on the other side there is a photo detector placed. So whenever this LED source is directly emitting light on the photo detector, there will be a signal generated as shown here. Okay, so now here there are no number of open windows available on the opaque disc, so the light can pass only through this open window. So whenever light passes, there will be a pulse generated. Say in one rotation you will get 10 pulses, so that will give us one rotation per second if it gets in 1 second, or say in 1 minute. So the speed is 1 rpm if 10 pulses are obtained in 1 minute. Say 100 pulses are obtained, 100 such pulses are obtained in 1 minute, in that case the speed will be 10 rpm, because 10 pulses in 1 rpm, so 100 means it will be 100 divided by 10, so that will be 10 rpm. So this relationship can be used to directly measure the speed of the rotor. So depending upon the number of pulses counted in 1 minute, so we can directly measure the speed of the rotor on which this disc is, this arrangement is placed. Okay, so thank you.